Hi Vikas, it's a pleasure to have you on the you know on the, for this little fireside chat, and thank you for making the time to do this.
Happy to be here.
Let me start by first, we all talk about, you know, we here at Horasys, we're talking about how the economy of India is shaping up, how the GDP is going to grow, what are the steps that need to be taken to, what does the government need to do, what are all the other aspects that need to really kick in to achieve the larger level goals. Having said that, everybody talks about critical factors, none of which mention knowledge as part of the list. My question to you really is how do you think knowledge is going to plug in and play a role in this entire and support, or will it lead the charge? Will it support? So I'm just trying to basically get your take on how Regalix is basically thinking about this and conducting itself. You're surrounded by technology companies, and but I'm sure that knowledge, which basically stems from the human mind, and then eventually gets translated into a lot of actionable intelligence through technology. But so tell us, how does this work?
Yeah, knowledge plays at multiple levels, and REST is a great format for knowledge exchange to happen at a certain level. This is where thought leadership from India and different parts of the world come together, and that is also a source of creating knowledge, sharing knowledge.
Sure.
If not so much creating knowledge.
Right, right.
But the interviews that we do here do contribute to creating a little bit of knowledge that can then subsequently be shared with a much wider,
correct,
broader audience group.
But how do you create the correlation, or how does it really plug in? I mean, can how much of knowledge is enough?
So first let's look at where knowledge resides, and then work backwards in terms of how much knowledge is the right amount of knowledge, or how it gets distributed more efficiently to who needs to get or consume the knowledge. You can talk about knowledge from a standpoint of a country or a nation or states, which Horasys focuses on. You could also talk about knowledge from within an enterprise or a company, and some of the enterprises are getting to size and scale that would dwarf most countries in at least smaller countries around the globe. And if you look at companies like Google and Apple of the world,
right,
they would easily dwarf countries.
So isn't knowledge also a ghost that a lot of people are fearful of now? I mean, you mentioned Google, and there is a lot of talk about data privacy, too much of data, too much of knowledge, too much of information.
So Google has a lot of information, and information can convert into knowledge, but it is still data, data privacy and all the arguments is really to prevent Google from having the right requisite amount of knowledge. It's not so much about the data in abstraction itself. The amount of data that Google collects, it's impossible for Google or anybody humanly to go figure out all the nuts and bolts to impact individual lives.
I hope so.
You can collectively make broader decisions, but
right,
you can't go targeting individual users. But anyways, the other part of knowledge is really about companies that are taking their products and services out to the market. And if you look at most companies, the knowledge around the product resides in the minds of a few within the company. And these are folks that are either in critical sales functions, people who are building the product, people who are supporting the product, and a handful of them who really become the anchors within organizations where the knowledge really sits and resides. And even within the organization, it's very hard to pick it out of their minds and distribute it and share it broadly. So if you look at knowledge broadly at a company level, or at a, we started with the national level, you're coming down to a smaller entity, a company. Knowledge creation and distribution continues to be a challenge. Most salespeople, if you look at a company of the scale of of Cisco or any other, most of the salespeople don't understand the product very well. The support is struggling to understand the product and the changes that product happens, leave alone the customers and partners and others who are struggling through the maze of how to understand what has been built.
Yeah, I think the life cycle management of knowledge itself
is very, very
is
cumbersome.
It's, yes,
it's very challenging. It's very onerous to create and document. And,
correct, absolutely.
And what we are trying to do is really play a part, small part in that process on how do you make knowledge creation much easier.
Right.
Because bandwidth of...
But are you focusing, sorry, so are you focusing mainly on creation alone or also dissemination?
Both. Both are the
because I think without the implementation or the dissemination, mm-hmm. I mean dissemination first and followed by implementation, mm-hmm. the creation becomes redundant.
Absolutely. Yeah. And so many knowledge systems have come around which focus on just storing and capturing knowledge
right.
without adequate focus on consumption, and that doesn't do anybody any favors. And we are looking at it from both ends of the puzzle.
Right.
How do you make it easy to create? Because knowledge is at a premium in the minds of a handful of folks within an organization.
Right.
And their time is really at a premium.
Right.
And how do you take that and disseminate that in formats that is consumable for people who need to consume it?
Right.
So when, for example, in a company, a support technician needs to troubleshoot an issue, they're looking at very pointed information. They're not looking at reading through a 5,000-page document to understand how to troubleshoot it.
Correct.
And that is where dissemination becomes very important, because you just need to abstract out that bite-sized content and make it available to them.
Correct.
In the context and in so the way they're looking at.
So in digestible size.
That is correct.
That can. So tell me about Regalex, and mm-hmm. you know, how is it that so? I understand that you are in already into knowledge creation, or basically.
So our philosophy. Let me answer that. If I. Our philosophy really is at the heart of any business is really the product and the service. And sitting right next to the product and service is the knowledge around the product and service themselves. The operating entities that an organization invests and builds, for example, a sales organization that goes out and wins new business for the company and pushes out the product and services, needs to consume the product knowledge to understand what the product does, how one version of the product is different from another version of the product, and the context in which the product can be applied to the customer. All that knowledge needs to be disseminated. They need to understand that. And it's humanly impossible for most people to understand the ins and outs of every product every single time that they interact with. So this needs to be available to them on the fly when they need it,
right.
In the context that they need it.
So do you also work with your clients to not only create this or harness this knowledge for them, mm-hmm. but also in adoption?
That is correct. So
do you kind of go the whole nine yards? Or
absolutely.
Is it limited to just a particular...
No, we actually go the entire... I would say the 10 yards,
okay.
Not even the 9 yards. For a lot of our businesses, although we start with knowledge as the at the heart of it, in some cases we end up operating some functions for the customers as well. For example, we do a lot of work operating the sales and marketing functions for companies on one end,
mm-hmm.
that bring in net new customers.
Mm-hmm.
And on the other end, we end up operating... customer success and support operations so that customers can be onboarded better, and through increased customer sat, businesses can maximize profits and revenues from customers that have
been acquired. Interesting. So that means you basically have a managed services piece as well.
That is correct.
That is offered to them as a separate independent module.
That is correct.
As a client, they can actually cherry pick what are the kind of services that they would really like to avail of, and maybe upgrade, downgrade depending on their needs evolve.
That is correct.
Okay.
I mean, our philosophy less lies in terms of creating and delivering business impact. And business impact in our context really is top-line revenue.
Of course.
And as long as we can deliver that impact
right.
to businesses, everything else becomes a derivative and an abstraction from there. And we've been fortunate where we work with some of very, very fast-growing companies, companies like Google, Amazon, of the world, that rely on us to create sizable portions of their businesses that we end up delivering and operating. So
I know you're located in the Bay Area in California, but so does the does your operating footprint expand beyond the U.S. At this point in time?
That is correct. We have a large operations in India.
You do?
Okay. Multiple locations in India. We have operations in Poland to cover mm-hmm. Europe, and we are setting up operations in Australia to cover that part of the world.
Interesting. So you've obviously been able to create the balance between the operating environments, which obviously is pretty diverse. So you've created, yes. You struck that right chord. That's interesting.
It's always a journey.
It is indeed. It is. All right, so thank you. I think this was a great insight into what you're doing and how knowledge is, I think, at the fulcrum or the keystone of all forms of development or all forms of tangible, oblique, intangible work that one would aspire to do.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's
thank
what
you for your time. Such a
thank
pleasure.
Thank you for having me.